It is just a huge honor today to be podcast interviewing Dr. Richard Lee Kinn, all the way from Dublin, Ireland. Thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Thank you so much for the invitation, Howard.
So it's 1 o'clock here. It's the lunch hour. What time is it in Dublin?
It's in the evening time. It's 10 past nine.
10 past nine? What time's your bedtime? do you want me to go hurry up so you can go to bed?
No, I love radio.
So Richard was born in Dublin in the 70s, not far from where he practices now. He grew up in the inner city, and his journey and career in dentistry has traveled a million miles over the years. He graduated dental training in 1995, spent a period of time in hospital training in the United Kingdom, then returned to private practice. Never satisfied, he decided to make the biggest decision of his life and return to college as a mature student while running a busy practice at the same time. His full-time, three-year postgraduate periodontal training in the dental hospital in periodontology was completed in 2010. His particular research during that time focused on nano-surface implant technology and bone augmentation materials funded by 3i Biomet Zimmer, the U.S. company based in Florida. He now holds a doctorate in clinical dentistry periodontology and a diploma from the European Federation of Periodontology and established the Mint Clinic in 2012, where his practice is limited to periodontology and dental implantology. He is a lecturer, mentor, and advisor to many companies. He has written numerous articles and publications, but it is the last 5 years that has seen incredible change in Richard's life, where he has constantly sought to push the boundaries and is now involved with Charity Radio FM and Ireland's first oral and dental health symposium to take place in May. Now, when people are reading this title, Dr. Yes. Richard Lee Kinn, they're going to be expecting to see a Chinese guy, not some Irish guy from Ireland. So how did you get a last name Kinn, K-I-N?
Well, you know, that's the million-dollar question, Howard. It started a long time ago. My father actually is a Chinese doctor. At the time, he was a student, and his parents left China in the 1920s. They traveled on a little boat to an obscure part of the West Indies called Trinidad. From there, they set up a little shop in the middle of absolutely nowhere and put 11 children through university just through sheer hard work. And one of those children was my father.
Wow. Now, is it Trinidad or Trinidad and Tobago?
Yeah, Trinidad and Tobago. Tobago is a little island off the coast of Trinidad, just about 9 miles. Actually, a lot of people probably don't know.
So it's two little islands that are the same country, Trinidad and Tobago? It's pronounced Tobago?
Tobago, yeah. It's a little island, tiny. You can get around it in a few hours, Howard, and it's absolutely beautiful.
Well, that's, now you know I drink when I'm in the Caribbean, because I actually went to Trinidad on a cruise and didn't even pick up the correct pronunciation of it. So I need to drink less when I'm on a cruise in the Caribbean. So have you ever got back to Trinidad?
No, it's unfortunately, as time has progressed, as I got older, it's been very difficult to get back. And it's far away, Howard. I mean, it's 12 hours in a plane. So I haven't seen my dad in a number of years.
So your dad is in Trinidad?
Yeah, he studied medicine in Ireland years ago. I met my mom, and then he went back after he had finished to practice medicine over there. And I left actually Trinidad when I was 18. So I spent about 10 years there, Howard, and then I came back home where I am today.
Huh. Well, maybe we should do a dental seminar together in Trinidad. It'd be a business thing. No, I'm dead serious. We have a yearly townie meeting. Our 15th annual townie meeting is going to be in Caesar's Palace, April 19th to 21st. So, but I got a team that sits there the rest of the year, not having things to do. So we put on little seminars. And if you get how many dentists are in Trinidad and Tobago?
Not that many.
Maybe we should put on a Dentaltown meeting where you speak in the morning, I'll speak in the afternoon.
Great.
And it give you a reason to go visit your dad. So you did something interesting, and a lot of dentists listening to you right now are sometimes they think, gosh, maybe I should have been an endodontist, or maybe I could just go back to school and be a periodontist. And that's what you did. How was that going back to perio school after you were a full-time dentist?
Wow. Very difficult, Howard. I mean, you're surrounded when you go back to college, right? You're surrounded by the best, the guys and girls who are, you know, top gun, creme de la creme, super smart. And, you know, I'd been out of the loop for a long time, and technology had improved. And, you know, when you're studying nowadays, it's an art. It's a huge skill. Those PhD graduates, It's like you have a gene for studying, and they're absolutely brilliant. Great to be around, fantastic atmosphere, hugely challenging. And I think for anyone who's thinking about doing it, don't let age be an impediment, Howard. It should motivate you. It should be a challenge. And anything that is really difficult is actually worth doing.
And what is the mint clinic? I think that's neat because whenever I think of Irish, I think of green. And is it a green mint?
Do you like the name?
I do. I love the name. Where did the name come from?
Well, you know, when I first decided to set up my clinic, I engaged a group of PR specialists, and we came up with different names, actually. One of the first names, Howard, was Spring Clinic, because of, you know, rejuvenation. And then the second group of PR team said to me, mint's a nice name. It's clean. It's fresh. It's, you know, what you're doing as a periodontist is trying to get the best results for your patients. And mint has that, you know, cachet. It reflects the type of treatment you want to provide. It's fresh. It's clean. Unfortunately, it also has associations with the mint. In some countries, the mint is where they print, you know, dollar bills. You know, so coins. People say, wow, you must be minted, Richard. Well, not quite.
I just retweeted. If you want to follow him on Twitter, he's at Mint Clinic D2. What's the D2 stand for?
Dublin 2, Howard. That's where the clinic's located, in Dublin 2. In Dublin, it's postcoded. So the places that are on the south side of Dublin are even numbers, like 2, 4, 6, and 8. And the numbers that are on the north side of Dublin are odd numbers, so like 1, 3, 7, 9, for example.
Well, let's start with this. You know, older guys like me read dental textbooks. The younger millennials are the ones that do podcasts. So yeah. You're probably talking to a lot of kids, and they all say the same thing. They say, I came out of school, I didn't place one implant.
Yeah.
How does some 25-year-old girl who's commuting to work right now, that's what podcast is doing. It's killing radio. Most of these American dentists have an hour commute each way to work. So she's commuting to work right now, listening to you in Dublin, Ireland, and she's saying, how do I go from I graduated, didn't place one, to a guy like you? I mean, do I got to go back to school and be a periodontist? What advice would you give her on her journey?
Well, you know, that's a really, really good question, Howard. I suppose, first of all, you need to find a passion in dentistry. Well, I practiced, you know, in general dentistry for a long, long time before I made the decision. But even during those years, Howard, I was continually training and studying in the hope that eventually, if I decided to go back to college, I would have the qualifications to get onto a program. Now, not everyone has to do a program to get to become, you know, an implantologist or to provide to place implants. I mean, in Ireland, for example, and in the UK and in Europe, there are very few specialists who are called implantologists. There's no actual recognition for it. Dentistry, placing implants in dentistry, to me, is going to become a routine procedure, like Invisalign, like aesthetic dentistry. There will be cases where a lot of practitioners, general dental practitioners, will be doing a lot of single unit cases. But as I say to a lot of the students that I mentor, implant therapy is actually far more difficult than you think. You need to choose your case carefully. And if you're choosing your case carefully and you follow good guidelines and you've been trained well, then you're going to get into very little trouble. And a lot of the cases that that happen for you know, young graduates that are coming out that get into trouble with implants, it's because they haven't assessed the case correctly, or they haven't been trained, or they become overconfident. Now, overconfidence is a good thing, and it's also a bad thing, because I think for some of the younger graduates, you need to have experience tempered with knowledge, and that comes with time. And you know, I've been practicing for 20 years, so I've been lucky, Howard. I've been trained by some of the best. So I know a lot of the cases that can and can't be dealt with easily and should be appropriately used by trained dentists who are comfortable in that area. But, you know, implants, choosing your case, it's not going to be the sole remit of specialists, Howard. It'll be a lot of general dentists will be doing them in the future.
Well, we'll talk about that. Keep her out of trouble. What is the parameters of a great case selection? And then what are the nightmares that you don't want to do until you've
placed? Simplest cases, Howard, to do right are those areas where, you know, you go through your list, you know, you fully assess the patient. You've got a patient who is not medically compromised, healthy, preferably a single unit missing in a very visible high aesthetic area, like an upper premolar, good quality bone. You know, you've done all your measurements, you've checked the status of the adjacent teeth, you've made sure that there isn't any vital anatomy that's going to compromise your case, like, you know, the sinus, for example. So in those cases where you've got a lot of bone, good access, the patient, you know, is not medically compromised, those are good cases to start with. And again, you know, if you're going to invest in an implant, this is the thing. I wrote an article a couple of years ago about implant therapy. At the last count, Howard, there was something like 700 different implant systems out there. It's an absolute minefield. And they're actually trying to introduce what's called an implant passport system now to try and make it easier for patients who, because I don't know if you have that problem in America, but in Ireland, there's a lot of patients who transfer between European countries with different implant systems. And it's a nightmare to find out exactly what implants we're dealing with here. Because sometimes we have to do either the restorative aspect of it, or we have complications surrounding the implant. We don't know what system that's in there. And they don't know either, because they all look the same to them.
One of the questions they have is smoking. What are your thoughts when she's picking a great case, plenty of bone, it's a not in the aesthetic zone, there's no perio, it's a great case, but they smoke a pack a day?
Well, you know, that's the subject of an entire different podcast, Howard. Where do we begin? Well, we know from all the studies, Grossi in the 1980s, and a huge amount of research, that smoking is an issue for implant patients, not just at the time of placing the implants, but even going into the future, whether they're going to develop implant problems in terms of bone loss, perimucositis, and implantitis. They're massively on the increase, and it's an awful and risk factor. And smoking is an out and out risk factor. Now, the thing about smoking is interesting, because a lot of our patients, and I'll get, you know, to the point whether or not you should treat these patients or not. Some surgeons actually have a rule about not treating patients who are smokers. Now, it's not what I would do in my clinic. We have a rule which we need to be, you know, we'd need to be mindful of smokers. Now, some of the smokers, for example, we try, and obviously it's important that we try and get them off the cigarettes, Howard. So we also, in my clinic, we also have doctors and psychiatrists that work close to us. So we have a very strong smoking cessation clinic. And one of the fundamental aspects of treatment is also to work with them closely. But smokers can be very difficult to treat. Sometimes they don't even tell you they're smoking, and they don't sometimes tell you how many they're smoking. Or they might think, for example, it's not, you know, the dentist doesn't need to know if we're smoking or not, or what type of cigarettes. And some patients are going on to e-cigarettes. You know, that's we need to find out, you know, what type of cigarettes they're on, how many they're smoking. And fundamentally, that's going to affect our treatment plan. Now, some surgeons will adopt what's called a smoking holiday when it comes to placing implants, Howard. They'll say to patients, well, you know, we don't want you smoking before, we don't want you smoking afterwards for a period of time. And it sometimes ranges between 2 to 10 days, for example, before and after. But the issue with smoking is very simple. Smoking is notorious. It causes all sorts of side effects. It causes poor healing. It creates inflammation. It creates a higher chance of infection. It reduces the blood supply to exactly the area we want to operate in, which is the implant itself. So these are all real risk factors. And, you know, another part of the discussion with your patients is consent. When you're talking to patients about consent, how important is smoking in that discussion? So, you know, if, and we've seen it sometimes, patients have gotten, some dentists have gotten into trouble in the past having talked about implant and implant failure, but never actually addressing the issue about smoking, which is really important.
You know, in 1850, 1 million Irish people left your island and came to the United States. And I wish the United States would have been more proactive and said, okay, we'll take the 1 million Irish, but we're going to trade you our 1 million attorneys. I think that would have been a much better immigration policy.
Well, you know what? We have 2,000 solicitors every year for 64 dentists that qualify in Ireland. So we have a huge number of solicitors in Ireland compared to the number of dentists. There's only 3 dental schools here.
So what was the ratio of dentists to lawyers to people?
2,000 dentists to 64. 2,000 solicitors to 64 dentists every year being produced in Ireland.
Wow. That was the health history. I wanted to ask about the smoking. That was a big caveat. But you were talking about there were 700 systems.
Yes.
You were talking about a passport system. So it's crazy because people in the United States is a very transient society. The urban areas have about a 10% flip per year. Usually they're chasing job mobility and that. So people are showing up on your door all the time with all these.
Yeah.
So what's the passport system?
Well, it's in its infancy, Howard. The plan is to have a universal database of implant systems and to have universal barcoding. And some specialists and some dentists in Europe particularly are considering introducing something like that and giving it to the patient. Now, you know, in its most dentists are actually doing that, Howard. Like, for example, you know, the systems I use, the TRI, which actually is based in Florida, has a coded system on it, and it's barcoded. So we give
our
patients.
Which system are you using?
I'm using the 3i Zimmer system, Howard.
The 3i Zimmer.
Yeah, 3i Biomet Zimmer.
Yeah, that's the largest implant company in the world, isn't it?
Well, it's, you know what, that's a debatable topic. It all depends on, you know, your perspective. I mean, the market in terms of implant work, there's probably about five huge international companies. They all claim, you know.
Who are the five large international?
Well, the five largest are probably Nobel, Straumann, Ankylos, Zimmer, and Southern. But, you know,
Nobel, Straumann, Ankylos, Zimmer, and what was the last one?
And Southern implants.
Southern? Yeah, but those four of those five, I mean, Zimmer does hips, knees, spine. They do everything. Does Nobel, Straumann, Ankylos, and Southern do all the other body parts too?
Well, Nobel, you know, Nobel's interesting, Howard, because if you know the history of implants, Nobel was the first to introduce the osteograded implant. It was invented basically by an orthopedic surgeon, Professor Brandemark, in the 1960s, actually completely by accident. He was putting these screws into rabbits, and he found that, oh, wow, this one couldn't come out. So when he started to doing the analysis on it, he found that the implants had integrated so well that they couldn't be removed. And this is actually the forerunner of all the implant systems that we see today. But yeah, a lot of these companies dabble. In fact, that's another thing. You'll see an awful lot of amalgamation of these companies, Howard. 700 implant companies can't exist. So you're seeing amalgamation, and a lot of the bigger companies started to absorb some of the smaller units and just buying them out for market share. So I think in the future there'll be a lot of companies that will disappear, and you'll effectively probably have two trains of implant companies, Howard. You have the very expensive high-end product, and you'll probably have a middle ground. I think the low grounds are probably going to disappear because I think, you know, people will get fed up with just, you know, implants that are very cheap, poor track record, and probably fail quite quickly.
So your favorite is 3i Zimmer.
Yes.
And what percent of Zimmer is actually dental? It's what is it, only like 5% or something?
Yeah, it's quite a small percentage, I think, Howard. So it's
and the reason I was so excited to get you on is not only is the fact that there's been a lot of new research on implant coatings, and that's what you're big into.
Yeah, that's one of my interests. But my main interest, actually, I hope we can talk about it later on, is the future of oral health and the symposium that I'm thinking of doing in Ireland, actually, in a couple of weeks. Sorry, bear with me for 1 second. I just need to move the system. Yes, implant systems are quite complicated at the moment, Howard. You're seeing the development of nanotechnology coming to the forefront of the products. And what is the American experience of nanotechnology, Howard?
Well, I mean, it's supposed to be the next big thing. I mean, I don't know if it's really here yet. I don't know if it's bleeding edge or leading edge, but Wall Street likes the word nano. Investors like the word nano. I mean, everybody knows.
Nanotechnology it actually isn't really a new phenomenon. It's probably been around for a very long time. And if you're looking specifically at the implant, what they have been trying to do over the last number of years is to look at the very, very cellular part of the implant, the actual just surface at a very high resolution, sometimes 10 to the 9th power. Now, these surfaces are actually very difficult to quantify, Howard. And I don't want to get into the technical details about implant surfaces, but, you know, there's what's called the macro part of the implant. You know, the bit that you can see, you know, that's the bit you showed your patients, all the, you know, look at the beautiful treads around your implant, you know, the top of it. Sometimes it's coated, sometimes it isn't. And then as you put your microscope onto the surface, you're looking at finer detail, like the microscopic surgery, for example, like the porosities within the actual implant itself. And then as you get really further down, it's like the stuff of science fiction. This is where all the companies now are targeting. See, the thing is, implants have been successful for so long. For those companies to get an edge, they have to have something unique. So, you know, their USP, their unique selling product. And those companies that are looking for the breakthrough are those that are saying, you know what, if you use our implant system, you might get integration that's occurring faster. So you can go from telling patients, you know what, it's going to take 3 months to get this implant constructed, or we can just go straight to using our implant system and we might get it much quicker. Now, that's actually not proven to be quite true. And no matter how good the technology now, even at the nano level, we still haven't been able to create the surface that can bind really quickly, heal really quickly. So the new generation of implants are saying, we're going to coat something onto the surface. Now, lots of different companies are out there claiming their product is better than the others. And I'm not going to specifically mention one or the other. But now what companies are also using are specialized products that can actually render the surface antibacterial. Because, you know, some of these implants fail, Howard. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what your implant failure rates are in America. Over here in Ireland, you know, on average, it's between 2 and 5%. And they're still looking to get those figures down even further. Because these are expensive procedures and patients want to get the best results. So some of these companies are coming out with surfaces now that they're coating with effectively an antibacterial solution, which will, you know, reduce the rates of failure even further. Now, that's the holy grail. Can you imagine if we have a product? Even the orthopedic surgeons don't have 100% track record. And they're, you know, hip implants, they're knee implants, you know, they are titanium as well. They don't say to patients, this is 100% success. Imagine if we can get our implant rates down to 98, 99. That would be fantastic, Howard. So that's where the cutting edge is taking us. To have
With like a hip transplant, if the patient gets a staph infection, it's just a nightmare. So to be able to make a hip in titanium hip that can't have a staph infection on it would just be game-changing.
It's huge. And I think a lot of these companies right there, their research budget is focused particularly on the surface and making it rendering it as clean and as biocompatible as possible.
I had a patient about 5 years ago that went in for a standard hip transplant and got a staph infection, and he was in the hospital for 1 year to fight this infection. And basically his wife, no one thought he'd ever leave the hospital. They thought he would die. So, I mean, these staph, and he said that, you know, everything was done right. It was just a routine staph infection.
It's not just a problem in America, Howard. It's an international problem. MRSA and the resistance to antibiotics now is becoming huge. And, I mean, it's not long before there'll be most of the antibiotics we have will be rendered useless. So they're still looking for new antibiotics that can help our patients. But you're quite right. Some patients go into hospitals with just a relatively straightforward procedure, ending up getting a complication. It's quite difficult to treat.
I want to ask you two more implant questions, and you can go into your next subject. You're a periodontist. You place implants. A lot of these kids listening to you, when you say the implant failure rate is a certain percent, in the clinic you see twice that amount where they have peri-implantitis. The patient's eating, chewing. The patient thinks there's nothing wrong. There's no pain. They can eat whatever they want.
Yeah.
But you're sitting there looking at, you know, very inflamed gum tissue. What would you tell these kids to think about when they see peri-implantitis? How would they treat it? And when would you sit there and say that implant has to come out?
Now that's really important, Howard. The thing is, you know, there's a difference between success and having long-term success, okay? So, you know, when we say, you know, initially we have a failure rate of 2-3%, to patients that isn't really significant. It means that, okay, we could lose the implant early, you know, within a few days or a few weeks after the implant's been placed. What you're referring to there is oftentimes an issue that's really going to be significant in the future, I think. We're seeing a lot. It all depends on the evidence that you look at. And again, I'm not getting really into the technical aspects, but a lot of these cases now are beginning to develop mucositis. And this is the forerunner to the precursor to longer term issues. Now, what do the young graduates need to look out for? Well, do you know what? The first thing I would say to young graduates is you know, go to a clinic that's placing implants, offer your services for free, and go in and listen, sit down, have a look, see what they're actually doing, see the procedures being done, watch the implants being going in. Very important, because you know what? If you're looking at an implant and Howard, you're not seeing, you know, where that implant has been placed, you don't get an appreciation of exactly what the architecture of that implant is doing. And some of these are a work of art. You know, the components to these implants, you need to see what the ground level is like, what the conditions when that surgeon was placing that implant, what was done. Was it a tissue level implant? Was it placed at crestal? Was it placed, you know, whatever. This is really important. If you're a graduate, offer your services for free. Go in and say, listen, you know what? I'm going to take half a day off. I'd love to see what you're up to. And get a mentor who's really good in doing that. You asked me a question earlier about where did these graduates start from. This is something I did. I went to the best and I said, listen, you know what? How can I help you? Can I write, you know, can I help you write up some articles? Can I see you doing some, you know, your surgery? Do you mind if I just tag along? I'd be very happy to do whatever you'd like me to do. Just maybe half a day. Go in, watch what they're doing. Watch the cases as they develop, as they progress later on. And then you might get confident starting to put your own in. You get an idea of where those implants are. So when it actually comes to seeing an implant in your practice, you're not really like, wow, what's this? You have a pretty good idea of what that implant should look like in a healthy state. You should also have a pretty good idea of what that implant is doing in an unhealthy state. And there's a lot of parameters, Howard. You know, we've very clear guidelines on what constitutes mucositis and peri-implantitis. It shouldn't be getting to the stage of developing, you know, bone loss and significant inflammatory issues. If it gets to that stage, you haven't done your job. You need to get in and look at that patient very early. So closely monitoring the implant. And in my clinic, we have a very strict protocol on once the implant's in, we make very detailed records. Sometimes we even take photographs of the implant being placed. Then afterwards, we will follow that case through. Initially, we will follow that case through very closely for the first year, Howard. And then as time progresses, you know, and we're confident there's no issues around this implant, we will be taking measurements over a period of time to make sure there's no issues around it. But it's also, you know, it's very important that the patient engages with the discussion here, Howard, that the conversation about maintenance of an implant is very important. A lot of patients traditionally thought once implants were put in, they were disease resistant. Far from it. They aren't disease resistant. And, you know, patients need to be engaged in the conversation about exactly how to look after their implants. Very important.
Well, I think one of the most misinformation campaigns that that the dental universe has created is a lot of these young grads believe when they see a molar and it's got periodontal disease or maybe it starts to have furcation involvement, they think the easiest thing to do is just extract that tooth and place an implant. And no, so the pendulum has been swinging away from all the periodontal surgeries. We'll just treat that tooth with a forceps and replace it with titanium and it'll solve all your problems. And now, 30 years later, that's not really what you're seeing.
No,
it's not a panacea.
No, but I think the pendulum has swung back now in terms of preservation and tooth maintenance. I mean, if we look at all the new research that's been published, we know that keeping that tooth maintainable, even if it's in a compromised state, we can maintain that tooth for many, many years to come. And I mean, a lot of that research was done by, you know, the Americans in the 1960s and 70s, which was somewhat overlooked, and now it's becoming more fashionable. And also in terms of economics, Howard, it's far more effective and cost effective to actually maintain that tooth than it is to replace with an implant.
So let's change subjects. Tell us about futurehealthsummit.com, the global gathering for healthcare in Dublin, Ireland, 15 summits, 3,000 delegates, 160 speakers. Oh my God! What did you get into?
Well, we haven't heard you're coming over yet, Howard. That would have been a huge bonus. So what happened?
Actually, I will come over because my mom is 78, and there's a little village, Ferran, and it's on her bucket list, and so depending on the dates. Email me, howard@dentaltown.com.
I will.
I'll reply to you and my brother and my mom. Great. And see when this is, because it'd be nice to kill two birds with one stone. And I'm really dreading going. I asked my mom, what do you want to do when you're in Ireland? That was my first question. You know what she said? I want to see every single church in Ireland. So I thought, okay, my brother's taking you. Let's get Paul on this deal. I mean, so that would be really nice
Yes.
to sneak away from my mom for a couple of days and go to your summit. But maybe we can do both. But when is it?
It's on the 24th and 25th of May, and the speakers are arriving. We're going to have all the speakers on the 24th. There's so much to talk about the symposium, Howard, that we could take hours. But I'll just tell you a bit of the background, Howard. 2 years ago, someone from the company, the Future Health Summit, decided to have a dentist actually speak for the first time at the summit. And they asked me because they actually knew someone who knew someone. And they said to me, "You know what? Why don't you come and talk about diabetes and periodontal disease, Howard?" So I was delighted because, it's a huge opportunity. I was the first dentist to be asked. And, to be talking in front of such a big number of people is very frightening. And I love challenges, absolutely. And that's something that I would say to you most, some of the younger dentists that are coming out there. Don't be frightened. Engage, do what scares you, because it's when you get to the limits, that's actually where you start producing your best work. When I was asked, I was actually surrounded by, the top specialists, the consultants in Ireland, some of the guys who actually wrote, the recent guidelines on diabetes in Ireland. And I don't know, Ireland is actually very similar to America. We have huge issues in terms of diabetes and obesity. We're in Ireland, we're getting we're one of the fastest growing obese nations in Europe, and we have huge health issues that are already on our doorstep and are fundamentally shaping our healthcare for years to come. And our rate of diabetes has absolutely escalated. So my talk last year was really current. It was talking about, the link between diabetes and dental decay and periodontal disease, and it went really well. So well, in fact, that the investors said to me, "Well, you know what, Richard? We'd like you to set up your own symposium on the 24th. So for the last year, we have been dreaming big, Howard. We've gotten two of the biggest speakers in the world coming from America, Professor Sebastian Ciancio and the man himself, Professor Stephen Offenbacher, coming over to talk. Absolutely incredible, that they've agreed to come over. We're bringing a couple of speakers from all over the world. Stephen Lynn, who's been on TED Talks. We have the head of the Irish Dental Association, our own PJ Byrne, talking about the Irish perspective. We have one of the leading authors in Ireland, a lovely lady called Leah Mills, who's going to talk about oral cancer. She wrote a book with one of the consultants in the hospital. We're getting another consultant in oral care medicine. And we've put together a huge team, and this is going to take place on the 24th, and lots of other things will be happening on the 25th as well. We're going to have, guest speakers. We're going to bring in dental chairs. We have lots of sponsorship deals. We're going to have a speed networking day, and we also got a poster presentation which is open to all the students in Ireland, and they are going to be presenting their posters on the 24th, and the winner's going to get a great prize. Even all the people who have just given a poster have gotten access to the symposium for 2 days. So it's going to be a huge turnout. Really looking forward to it, Howard.
On Twitter, this is at Health Ireland calling abstracts. I just retweeted that to my 20,000 Twitter followers,
Wow,
so hopefully
thanks.
that'll get some traction. So, who were the two American speakers that were coming over that you were excited about?
Professor Stephen Offenbacher.
I'm on your website, futurehealthsummit.com.
Yes.
Is he on the
He's on the speakers list, Howard, if you go into the speakers list,
right?
and you can
Well, you got
see
so many speakers. I mean, I'm scrolling forever. Man, you got a lot of people coming. So it
Yeah.
was Professor what?
So, Professor Stephen Offenbacher.
Stephen Off. Well, let me see. Ian Grant, Berta, Donna. Oh, you said, was one of them Sebastian G. Ciancio?
Yep, that's Professor Sebastian, yeah.
And the other one was who?
Stephen Offenbacher. Well, there's about eight speakers, but they're our guest speakers, Howard.
Yeah, I still haven't found him. But anyway, yeah, that the so we always hear on St. Patrick's Day that America's about 14 percent alcoholics, but a lot of people throw around numbers that Russia's the highest alcoholism rate at like 40%, Ireland's number two at like 38%. Are those numbers true, or is that exaggerated?
Well, I don't know how they get those figures, Howard. I mean, a lot of that is anecdotal, and you know, it's myth busting, and you know, there's a romanticism about people in Ireland drinking. You know, to be honest, and this is my own personal take on it, right? The last and a lot of my friends don't drink. There's a movement, you know, people now, if they're going to drink, they're going to drink sociably. They're going to enjoy themselves. And there's, you know, a lot of fun, and there's a lot of merriment. You know, Ireland is a fabulous place for young people. And, you know, alcohol has gotten a bad reputation in Ireland. But I think, you know, I think the younger population now are beginning to change an awful lot. I think you're going to see those figures really fall in the future, Howard.
Well, we always assume that all Irish people are drinking Jameson whiskey while listening to U2.
Well, not quite.
Is U2 your favorite band since you're from Ireland?
The U2 are great. You know, they're not my favorite band. I love some of their music. I mean, you know, the thing is, the Ireland of today, Howard, is unrecognizable. If you were to pop down to where my clinic is, within 2 miles of my clinic, you've the highest concentration of some of the leading companies in the world. LinkedIn, Google, Skype even, Microsoft, Facebook, Dropbox, all of those companies are within 2 miles of each other in the inner city of Dublin. And it is absolutely fantastic. And, you know, the energy that Dublin gives off now is enormous. So I think for any of your viewers that are listening to this, Dublin and Ireland is a fantastic place, not just to visit, but to come and work. We have wonderful facilities. I mean, it may not be as warm as Arizona, but, you know, I think we have a lot to offer.
So Ireland is you're in Dublin. That's not part of the United Kingdom. That's separate Ireland.
Yeah, that's
and
Southern
you're,
Ireland.
You're still part of the EU, right?
Yeah, we are. And that's you know, some of the biggest changes now that are taking place is because England has decided to leave the European Union, the so-called Brexit. I don't know how the Americans are taking that, but it's going to have profound changes in Ireland because you know. We've had trading relationships with the UK for years. A lot of our dentists have traveled. I worked in the UK, for example, in the 1980s, and it's going to fundamentally affect a lot of the relationships that we have with the UK. In fact, the UK is our biggest trading partner. Even though, you know, we like to think that we're European, it's very important that we manage the negotiations that are going to take place in England over the next 10 years.
Do you think it'll be good for the UK to Brexit, or do you think it's going to be bad?
You know, it's a billion-dollar question, Howard. Very few people know, and those who do are giving perhaps, you know, opinions that have vested interests. They all have, maybe they represent some company. But I think there's positives and negatives to be gained. I think there's advantages and disadvantages. I think any business that relies solely on one country to trade is going to be in a difficult position. I think they need to be exposed to a number of markets, and I think they need to prepare themselves for the worst-case scenario. I don't think the relationship with England is going to change. It won't. I mean, there will be, you know, England is still going to be there, and they're going to still need to have a business relationship with them. But I think the mechanism is going to change. And I think a lot of businesses now need to be looking further afield.
Well, let me just ask this question, because I'm curious and over here, like you look at all the debt problems that Greece has and, you know, and all this stuff. Like that. So let me just ask a really long-term question. Like, who's that little girl sitting left of you in that picture?
My little girl, Charlie.
Okay, how old is Charlie?
She was two in that, and she's eight now.
Okay, she's eight.
Yeah.
When she's as old as you, how old are you?
Me, I'm 44.
Okay, when she is 44, do you think the EU will still be together?
Wow. I think it'll be together because, to be honest, Howard, I think there's too many people that have invested an awful lot in Europe, and I think I think the political will of the people in the current environment want Europe to stay, you know, contained. I can see one or two other countries probably disappearing by then, and I think Europe will be a smaller group of countries, but I think it's still going to exist in one form or another. I don't think it'll be as big as they had envisaged, Howard. I think it'll be a smaller group of, you know, I think I can't see how France and Germany, you know, some of the bigger countries can see themselves out of Europe because I think there's too many benefits.
So now you're also doing, you're involved with a charity, Radio FM, Ireland's first oral and dental health. So now you're on the radio.
Yes. Actually, Howard, I've been doing radio for a couple of years. I've been asked, you know, to go in and, you know, I talk a lot about the business of dentistry, Howard. You know, the business of dentistry is fundamentally, it's changed so much in the last couple of years. You know, it's recognized as a business as well as a clinic, which is a really interesting model. I mean, that's something, you know, we could talk about at another stage. How do you run your clinic and run an ethical business? Those are real issues that dentists, self-employed dentists, struggle with every single day. That's huge. I'm really interested in that. And, you know, one of my real interests is talking to businesses. So, you know, some dentists will ring me up and say, Richard, you know what, I'm thinking of selling my clinic. What do you think I should do? And, you know, I do all of that, you know, pro bono, Howard. I'll pop up to the clinic, have a look, do some research, write a little, you know, some notes, advantages, disadvantages. Unfortunately, the funny thing is, Howard, of the four clinics I've visited in the last year, all of them I've said, you should just sell the building because that's all it was worth. They couldn't sell the business. It was too late.
And why was it too late?
Howard, my dad said to me years ago, the day you want to sell your business is the day you buy it. You need to actually think of your exit strategy as soon as you look at moving into the clinic or buying it. Now, I never understood what that meant until fairly recently because I sold my own clinic, which was really difficult, and I set up another one. So, you know, I know a little bit about the way buying and selling clinics runs, and it is a very difficult process. So if you're thinking of selling your clinic, you need to act a lot longer. You know, you need to have a long-term strategy. You need to think about your clinic long before you sell it. That's the key. And get the team that are going to sell it for you in place long before you decide. Because you know what? Time moves on really fast, Howard. You would be amazed that, you know, you talked, you know, about what my little girl is going to be doing when she's 44. It's even faster than that. Before you even realize it, your time is up and you're going to be looking at the exit strategy for your business. And if you haven't put in place that exit strategy, you're going to be in trouble. And you know, in Ireland, we had a severe recession, Howard. Huge recession. A lot of dentists got caught out. Didn't plan properly. That's the thing. Got to plan ahead. Really important.
How's the economy doing now?
Really well. We've got growth rates for the last year averaging about 4 to 4.5%. This year is going to be on track for 6%, fastest growing economy in Europe. But it was a real bad medicine, Howard. The crash took an awful lot out of people in Ireland. It put back services, even dental services, by probably 20 years. There was huge cutbacks. People really suffered. And the collapse was, you know, we had probably the biggest collapse in Europe.
So are you starting to see corporate dentistry in Ireland where a chain has 5 or 10 locations?
Yep, they were in even before the recession, Howard. They knew they've been here for some time. You have companies that came over from the UK and they established, you know, corporate practices. And that was they're the main players. I'm not going to name who they are, but they're, you know, everyone who knows anything about dentistry will know who they are. And recently there's been more corporate entities coming in. It's an interesting model, you know, and it's you know, this again, that's a discussion for another podcast, you know, is the growth of corporates versus the single-handed clinician. I mean, the death of the single-handed clinician has been overrated, I think. You know, I think there's a lot of single-handed clinicians who actually hold the advantage. And this is something that I lecture about and I talk to the business advisors about. You know, they ring me up and say, Richard, you know what, corporates are here, what do I do? And the first thing I say to them is, well, look, let's go for a cup of coffee. Don't panic. It'd be okay. You know, unless you think of selling your practice tomorrow, and then you're in trouble.
So what do you, how big do you think they'll get in Ireland and the UK?
Well, you know, there's a level to how fast you can grow, and there's a saturation point. You know, a lot of these corporates have done their homework, and they're looking strategically at certain locations, and it's all about, you know, the bottom dollar in terms of overheads, in terms of capital costs, in terms of fixed assets. So there is a certain level of growth. I mean, the Irish market is quite small, Howard. In Ireland, there's a little bit more than 2,000 dentists in Ireland.
And how many people?
Anywhere between 4.5 million and 5 million, according to the latest surveys. And we actually have a fairly low ratio of dentists. I think we're 20th or something in Europe, Howard, terms of dentist to patient ratio. So there's room for, you know, there's room for expansion, but we don't have that huge demographics of you know, a lot of, you know, incoming people or a huge growth rate of new people. So you're going to probably see a leveling off in terms of acquisitions in the market. And I think they'll probably be here for a long time.
Well, you know, when I got here in when I graduated dental school in 1987, Phoenix had no fluoride in the water and no dental schools. Now it has water fluoridation and two dental schools. One in Midwestern up Glendale, suburb of Phoenix, graduates 140 a year. AT still. It supply and demand is very real, and it has been an incredible game changer. I mean, in Phoenix, Arizona, it looks like there's a dentist on every corner.
Wow. And I mean, is that creating, like for the new graduates, would they see that as, you know, very stressful? Because, like, you know, in America, the perception is the students come out with huge overheads and, you know, real cost-based issues. So would that intimidate a new graduate coming out of dental college?
The bigger problem is that, you know, when you go to 8 years of college, you want to live in a big city with all the amenities. And so, you know, 2/3 of all the dental graduates stay right there in where they graduated in the big city. And then you only have to drive 1 hour away from any major. But by the time you get 2 hours away from a major airport, a lot of the towns don't even have one dentist.
Okay.
When you tell a kid to go live there, you know, they roll their eyes and they won't do it.
Yeah.
But everyone who goes there makes bank, and they'll work like 4 10-hour days, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then drive in Thursday night to the big city and party like a rock star. They'll party like Bono Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So, but that, you know, demographics means everything. Just like, you know, there's not any dentist in Ireland who would say, you know what, I'm gonna move to the Congo, or Afghanistan. I mean, demographics are huge.
You have a similar issue in Ireland. A lot of the graduates congregate where, you know, there's a heavily built population, and where you're right, there are amenities, infrastructure, and, you know, places to eat, places to go to, cinemas. But the thing is, they predict, Howard, that in 20 years, 70% of the Irish population will be living in Dublin or its outskirts.
But you know why I don't believe that? Because in my life, you know, you don't really figure out how everything works. You don't know where the universe came from. You know, I mean, when I graduated from college, 99.99999% of an atom, they told me, was empty space. Now they're like, oh, we mean it's filled with dark matter and dark energy. You know what I mean? So, but it's that linear thinking. When all I've seen, the pattern is the pendulum swings too far to left, swings back to the right. And I think this driverless car thing is going to be a massive downplay, put massive downward pressures on the big city, because when you're at home, it's hard to work from home because you got your children and family and spouse and dogs. And then when you get to work, it's hard to get anything done because of meetings, of people going to each cubicle and telling you what they're doing and talking. Yeah. And with driverless cars, when instead of driving the whole time and you just get into a box and there'll be your desk and your computer, I don't think you'll even care that you're a 2-hour commute from downtown big city, because it's going to be your private time where no dog, no cat, no spouse, no coworker, just get in there and hammer through your emails and your spreadsheets and get all your work done. Show up at work, do all the team building meetings, meet the whatever you have to do, then get back in your box, which is just going to be a desk, or it could be a bed and take a nap or whatever. But I think when you go to driverless cars, I don't think people are going to care about living 2 hours away from downtown.
Question, Howard, do you think that dentists will be here in 25 years?
Do I think dentists will what?
Will be here? Do you think we'll be practicing, or will be taken over by robots?
Gosh, I think I'm already seeing technology prototypes where they put a mount on a tooth.
Yeah. I've seen
the
tooth.
And then an automatic thing drills the prep, and you got CAD cam. You got and now CAD cam is being replaced by what is it? The printing.
Yeah, 3D printing.
3D printing. I mean, between CAD cam, 3D printing, robots, artificial intelligence. Yeah. I think the scariest thing in the future of economics is going to be Artificial intelligence. They're going to replace accounting, and I mean, so many functions.
Well, it's here now actually, because now they have bots that can, you know, a lot of dental questions that are coming into the systems now, for example, can be handled by bots. And I think in the future you'll probably have, you know, I think initially what will happen in the future will that dental practices will be smaller. There won't be a receptionist. All of those, you know, middle ground jobs will be gone. And eventually, I think dentists could be gone too, because, you know, you're quite right. I mean, if you can come, I mean, there will be some patients who will see dentistry as a commodity. They will say, you know what, I'm happy to go into a booth somewhere, get a robot to fix it, and go home, pay the equivalent rate, and might do a job as equally as good. I don't think dentists in my lifetime will be superseded, particularly those ones who have, you know, very technical skills in terms of specialization. And I think a lot of dentists now would be trained to be specialists in general dentistry. So I think that's the role that's going to change.
Well, I think the biggest problem with dentistry as a business or corporates or drones or whatever is that, you know, when you're making an iPhone or bottled water, it's a standardized product.
Yeah.
And when you go into dentistry, every time someone takes a study model and a full set of x-rays and goes and shows it to 30 dentists, they get 30 different treatment plans. The government did this and they showed it to 100, and only two treatment plans were the same. That was the two dentists that said it didn't need anything. And then treatment plan 3 to 100 were all different. And so when you go into corporate, they have the turnover of the employee associate dentist is off the charts.
But Howard, that's based, that premise is based on technology that is historical. Now, what you just said there, for example, in the future, they will have tests. They will have tests, for example, that can, they'll have saliva tests, they'll have proteomics, they'll have, you know, DNA analysis, they'll be able to detect periodontal disease. They'll be able to diagnose more accurately whether a tooth is decayed or not, or they can just monitor it. Those robots can do that with three-dimensional scanning, and they'll be, you know, for example, they have Diagnodent, which is a test for caries, but there's going to be a test that's even more sophisticated than that. In fact, to be honest, here's the thing, Howard. In future, all these diseases may not exist. You know, there could be a cure for, and this is the thing I'm going to talk about at the symposium. We are hopefully going to see the evidence that some of these diseases, the cures are going to be on the horizon. Not too far away, Howard. That could effectively create
A cure for what? You're talking about strep, dental decay, gum disease? What do you, a cure
all
for
those
what?
Things. Everything.
And how do you think the cure will look for caries and gum disease? Do you think it'll be a vaccine, or what do you think it'll be?
Actually, there's a paper produced in New Zealand, I think, recently about a vaccine that's going under trial for strep mutans for dental decay, which is one of the main etiologic factors in dental decay is the mutans bacteria. I don't think that's going to work because, you know, there's a whole issue around vaccination and getting ethical trials. And if you knock out one, you know, type of bacteria, will it create knock-on effects? So I'm not too sure. However, I think in the future there will be sealants, for example, that will completely protect teeth, render them impervious to all sorts of decay, resistance. And I think the bacteria – here's the thing, Howard. Bacteria have been on this planet 3 billion years. We are living in their territory. They're not living in ours. The mouth is a very complex, wonderful piece of equipment, contains something like 600 different bacteria. A lot of them, we don't even understand what they're doing in the mouth. Some of them good, some of them not so good. It's when that balance starts to get shifted that we start to see decay starting to develop. And I think we're not going to be able to try and manipulate the bugs in the mouth, because if you start to shift one ecosystem, you're moving the dynamic, creating potentially a battleground in another area. So I don't think that's going to be tampered with. But I think the teeth themselves are going to be protected. And I think periodontal disease, I think there'll be a cure for that in the next 20 years.
Well, you know, they're discovering a new species of bacteria in the mouth every quarter.
Yeah.
It's about 4 species a year. And then when you look at a cavity, you know, people say, oh, it's caused by Streptococcus mutans. By the time that cavity is 4 millimeters deep, there's not even Streptococcus mutans down there.
Yeah.
I mean, so it is like a zoo, and it's a very complex zoo. that people want to say. I want to ask you another question, because you're in Europe. I'm over here on the other side of the world, where only 1 in 6 people live. You're on the side where the other 6 out of 7 live. There's only 1 billion people living in the Americas. There's a billion in Europe. There's a billion in Africa. But anyway, 6 out of 7 Earthlings live on your side. And when we look at healthcare models, the Soviet Union and all of its satellite countries, dentistry was a stomatologist. It was in the med schools, and you would do the same curriculum, and this person would go off and become a dentist. This person would go off and be a stomatologist or OBGYN or whatever. But in America, in the late 1800s, University of Baltimore, the dentists needed a chair, and the physicians needed beds, and it was based on a chair sitting up and a bed that they split those two. And now it looks like 140 years later, those two are kind of getting back together because they realize the mouth is hooked up to the rest of the body, and and people are realizing that the oral systemic link. Do you think the Soviets had a better model with stomatologists part of physicians? Do you think it was a bad idea to have dentists separate from physicians and almost treat the mouth like it was in a completely different city than the rest of the body?
Well, you know, it's hard to say because I don't have much experience in the Soviet system. I mean, when my degree, we were with the doctors. You know, I'm sure it's the same in America. We were with the doctors, the med students for the first 2 years. We did, you know, a combined program, and then we went on to our respective hospitals then. And I must say, you know, that those first 2 years were essential, Howard. I mean, you know, to get insight into general medicine and to get insight into the body like anatomy, you know, what saddens me is that after we went our separate ways, we didn't, you know, network or connect. And I think this is the difficulty we're finding in Ireland. The dentistry, you know, remains disconnected from the art. Now, I hope the symposium is going to address that in a big way. And, you know, you made reference there, Howard, to the biggest change that's coming in healthcare in the future, which is the oral systemic link. And I think that's going to be a game changer. I think once we, you know, have the evidence, we're going to find that our healthcare colleagues, you know, the doctors and the nurses, we're all really going to be needing to work in the same boat. We're all really going to need to work together for the benefit of our patients. So I think that's going to be a big change coming.
Well, it's literally, it's so dysfunctional in the United States. Like hospitals, 8% of their emergency rooms are odontogenic toothache pain. Yeah. And that hospital can amputate a foot, do a bypass, remove a brain tumor. I mean, it can do anything, man, and it has no way of diagnosing a mouth. I mean, how are you imagine a grocery store and 8% of the customers wanted one specific item. What's the chance the grocery store would carry that item?
Well, you know, it's
guaranteed. I mean, every business in the world would not overlook 8% market share from their customers. If you always ordered that at the grocery store, they'd carry it. And the fact that 8 out of 100 visits to the emergency room in America with 320 million people have a toothache and they just stare at them. And what do they do with them? They give everyone on Pen-V-K and Vicodin, hydrocodone and Pen-V-K. I mean, it's just, it's insanity.
It's not just, it's not just America, Howard. I mean, it's endemic across the board. You have, you know, the sheer number of patients that are turning up in A&E and, you know, the proliferation of patients with non-essential life-threatening conditions that turn up because they're in pain. The thing is, you know, people are in pain. Dental pain is at the top level of – that's why, for example, dentists are in business, because, you know, people need our services, and thank God for that, you know. But the problem is a lot of these patients are going into A&E, you know, in the middle of the night or in the morning, clogging up the system. I mean, there's a huge burden on all resources and services. And you're quite right. I mean, if they had a dental team within the hospital, that would really, really help. No, I think actually it goes back further than that. I think the training that the doctors get has to be based, a lot of it has to be based, you know, working with us. And I think we also need to work with the doctors. Because you know what, Howard? In the future, dentists are going to be able to diagnose diabetes. They're going to be able to diagnose a huge number of systemic illnesses. There will be tests that we can do in our own clinics because we have the chairside facilities. We have access to, you know, we have access to patients' mouths. That's going to give us a huge amount of information. that information is going to be invaluable because we're going to be working with our colleagues more closely. And I think it works both ways. I think it has to be a synergistic arrangement. And I think there has to come a sea change in terms of the way healthcare is run. You know, I'm not, I think it's going to take time, Howard. I mean, when you're dealing with doctors, you're dealing with a very traditional group of sectors, you know, very strong interests, very strong opinions, have one particular philosophy about how medicine should be treated. And, you know, this whole thing about AI, for example, and robot, that, there's a lot of doctors who are very scared about that. Huge resistance in Ireland to those things.
Well, there should be, because in the military, in the United States, you know, when you go in a submarine or an aircraft carrier, you know, the submarines aren't big enough to have a physician.
Yeah.
And so they've had this program, so of artificial intelligence, if you have a problem, you know, you do it in. And anyway, long story short, whenever they test the Navy's artificial intelligence or their system of it asks you questions and you give it data versus the diagnosis from the emergency room physician, the computer's almost always right, and the emergency room physician is wrong 20-30% of the time. So you already seen that. That was the fastest hour ever. We're at an hour and 1 minute. It's, you got to go to bed. But I want to ask you one specific overtime question.
Yes.
You've mentioned diabetes two or three times.
Yes.
And some of these kids are probably want to know, exactly how does diabetes affect the oral health? How is diabetes and the mouth connected?
Yes. That's a really, you know, that's a fundamental question. Now, you know, I mentioned earlier, Howard, right? The explosion in patients, in younger patients now who are developing diabetes at a much earlier stage is endemic, okay? Our experiences in Ireland, it's heading to be one of the fastest growing rates of diabetes in the world. And the problem is, right, a lot of these patients actually are pre-diabetic. So, you know, the tests aren't sophisticated enough to detect it, but their glucose is getting higher and higher. So what happens really is that, you know, their blood sugars become thicker. Now, you know, of course, again, dietary related processed foods, sugars and fats, they're combined. What happens, right, is their blood sugar level, or what's called their HbA1c or glycosylated hemoglobin, starts to get thicker. So that glucose starts to bind to the red cells, okay? That creates a lot of issues, right? It puts real stress on the pancreas, which produces insulin. So eventually what happens, right, is the body, you know, can't break it down more quickly. So their insulin starts to become, you know, less effective or more resistant. So those patients, unfortunately, become what's called diabetic type 2. Now, the thing is, by the way, just, you know, not to confuse things as well, sometimes you actually mistake some of those patients because they actually may be type 1 diabetic. Interestingly enough, we thought that those patients who had diabetes type 1 were always young. In fact, to be honest, we're seeing older patients who are type 1. Anyway, not to confuse the matter. So your dentist, right? Here's the thing. Diabetes, you know, we talked about systemic conditions. We have the strongest evidence about diabetes and periodontal disease, okay? If you have diabetes, for example, you've probably a 3 times risk factor for losing a tooth through periodontal disease. So that's 3 times higher, okay? That's the first thing. And it works both ways. So if you have diabetes and your diabetes isn't well controlled, so your patients are going to the doctor, and for whatever reason, their first line of tablets isn't working, their, you know, glucose levels are up and down, what you're almost certainly going to see is you're going to see a mouth that's unhealthy. You know, you're going to see patients who have inflamed gingiva, really, you know, tissues that are very erythematous. You know, you'll have, you know, very significant high levels of bleeding. You'll have oftentimes advanced periodontal disease. And so what it is really is that if your patient has diabetes and if it's poorly controlled, almost certainly their gum condition is also going to be poorly managed. So you need to be putting them into a very strict maintenance and treatment program.
But is that because they're immunocompromised, or is it because they have less circulation, or what do you think the connection between the high blood glucose levels? How does that turn out to be gum disease?
Well, you know, the thing is, Howard, gum disease has a lot of similarities to a lot of the chronic inflammatory conditions that we see nowadays, like arthritis and diabetes. And it's due apparently to what's called a hyperinflammatory state. So what's happening, right, is that the body, right, is creating a lot of inflammatory mediators, and they're effectively creating the environment. It's causing, you know, a lot of patients who have gum problems will start, I mean, you know, specifically speaking, 80% of the entire world have mild inflammation or gingivitis, and yet only 10 to 15 develop more severe. But if you look actually at the most recent American research done a couple of years ago, some 20 to 40% of those develop moderate problems. So when you're superimposed a risk factor like diabetes on an unhealthy mouth, those mediators get effectively petrol. They become really active. The bacteria that create the environment for disease, the biofilm within the mouth, starts to use this lack of insulin regulation to become activated, and it causes the disease to become far more aggressive. But there's two ways that diabetes is important, Howard. It works the other way. So we've seen evidence, right, that patients who get their gum disease under control actually find that their glycemic control in diabetes improves. It means that their blood sugar level actually falls. Now, here's the thing. If we look at all the studies, most recently, all the systematic reviews and all the meta-analysis, they have found, right, that on average, there's a 0.4% reduction in glycosylated levels. Now, that might actually not seem a lot, but you know what? It's equivalent to a second line of a pharmacological drug. So if your patient is taking two drugs, one, the major drug, and finding that it's not effective, and their physician recommends another drug, in fact, what we've seen is the evidence shows that a 0.4% reduction is equivalent to that second line of drugs. Now, we're not asking patients to come off those tablets, but it's something that as dentists, as periodontists, we need to have a really frank discussion with patients and say, listen, you know what? Not only is this treatment for your condition going to improve your gum condition, which is really important, but there's an additional benefit of possibly reducing your glycosylated level. And that's a therapeutic intervention, Howard. That's not a drug. So you look at all the benefits. You may actually have to take less drugs, less side effects, less costs, a lot of benefits for patients. So I think that discussion with patients needs to be really, is really important when you're talking about diabetic patients and gum disease.
And you know, that disease is really spreading around the world. Like 30 years ago when, you know, America had the highest obesity in the world.
Yeah.
And now as a percent of population, and now it just fell behind Mexico. And, you know, 30 years ago, I live 100 miles from the border. 30 years ago, you used to go down there and it looked like you were in China. Everybody was fit and they were just fit. And you go to Mexico City now and it's actually, there's more heavy, big, huge people than when you go to Walmart in America. I mean, at 54, I totally saw it. I mean, now when you have to go to very poor countries or rural countries, to see places where everybody is fit. And then you start going to these emerging economies, and the first thing that was emerging is the waistline.
Well, you know, it's funny because they did a lot of studies in the 1960s and 70s with people who had repopulated, Howard, and they saw, you know, even when they were in countries that traditionally had a really good diet, you know, like places like Japan, for example, and they relocated to some of the, you know, the more advanced countries, what they found, right, is that their levels of diseases, you know, heart disease, cardiovascular disease, actually started to creep up as soon as they became, you know, local citizens of the area, of the environment. So I think, you know,
I see it in my practice, yeah, all the time. It's always this: the mom and dad and the grandparents are from India, and none of them had a cavity.
Yeah.
And there are two kids. One has 8 fillings and the other one has 12 fillings. And the mom says, yeah, they go to school and they like the pizza and the Coca-Cola and the deal. And when the parents and grandparents are still eating their traditional Asian diet and they have perfect teeth, you know, from China, Laos, Cambodia. I see it all the time. And their children have American teeth.
Absolutely. I think the whole area of diet in the future is going to be the battleground. I think, you know, as clinicians, as dentists, we're going to really struggle, you know, to get the oral health message over. It's going to be very important. In this country, we're introducing a sugar tax, a levy on products, you know, on fizzy drinks. I believe in San Francisco, they actually introduced it recently, and that's coming into play over here. Now, it's not a cure-all. I think, you know, what we need is we need to be able to use some of that money, particularly for oral health promotion, and that's going to be a positive thing. But I think
This is America. We don't want to change our diet or exercise. We just want to wait till they cure it with a pill. We're just gonna wait for the little blue pill, and then we can just eat cheeseburgers and never ever exercise and drink beer and Pepsi all day, and then they'll come out with the little pill. I mean, that's their mindset, and it goes all the way back 30,000 years ago to the medicine man. Every time you got sick, you go to the medicine man, and they make a lotion or a potion, and they would either cut something off or give you a potion. And here it is, 15,000 years later. And when you get sick, you don't want to change your behavior, diet, exercise. You want to go to the medicine man, and he's going to make a lotion or a potion. He's going to cut something off, like your tonsils, or you know.
Coca-Cola was a medicine originally, but you're quite right. We are hardwired to want certain foods, and that craving develops very early in life. It's programmed to our DNA. But I, you know what? I think it can be reprogrammed, Howard. I think it's difficult, and I think it requires a huge, fundamental change in your behavior, and you need a you need a very strong, proactive approach. And I think as well, as a dentist, we need to be looking, we need to be talking about diet with our patients. Very important that we get into that area, when we have that discussion. Diet and dental diseases now, something we need to engage our patients with a lot more.
Okay, well, on that note, I'm going to go eat a Hostess cupcake and have a big glass of Coca-Cola. Ryan, thank you so much. I know it's got to be 10 p.m. there. Thank you so much.
You're
I
welcome.
retweeted both of your Twitter accounts.
Thank you.
You ought to post it on a big deal about that in Dentaltown, because Dentaltown has a 1/4 million dentists, and
Wow.
4,000 of them are from the UK. And I've
Okay.
lectured in Ireland a couple of times, and there's a lot of Irish dentists in there. So do a big post on Dentaltown, and that'll be some great marketing for
Delighted to,
your.
Howard, and I look forward to seeing you in Ireland. I'll send you some information about the symposium.
And is there any chance I could just ship my mother to you and have her live with you for a year?
If
And
she's as lovely as you, no problem.
she is lovely. I'll talk to you later. Thanks for coming on
Thank
the
you.
show.